I see, you were at Wharton for a while, and then firstly, I want to know your story. You were at Wharton for a while, and then you went to INSEAD for almost 9 years, and then you're back. So please tell us how did this happen?
As most people in my line of work, I got a PhD in 2001, University of Rochester, and then my first job was at Wharton. So I joined Wharton 2001. I got tenure in 2007, and then after tenure, you have this sabbatical, which is, pretty nice perk of being a professor. So you can go anywhere you want for a year, and school kind of keeps paying you and keeps you on faculty. And I decided to go to INSEAD. So I went to France at that point of time, and I had absolutely no intention of staying beyond 1 year. And then after a year, we kind of liked the country. Kids were learning French, but they were not fluent yet. And INSEAD made me a job offer to join. So I kind of thought about this, and you kind of always think, well, once I'm retired, I will travel. But there was an opportunity to travel right away. Wharton and INSEAD had the alliance, which made the whole transition very, very easy. I was offered to run this alliance on INSEAD side, so I would still go to Wharton a lot. I would maintain connections with the school, with faculty in my department. So I said, yeah, that seems like a good move. So after visiting INSEAD for a couple of years, so 1 year was sabbaticals, and I took kind of a leave of absence for a year, trying to decide if I want to stay or not. And finally, after 2 years, I joined full time. I had absolutely no intention of living in Asia ever. I just never crossed my mind. And then at some point, I visited Singapore on some teaching assignment at INSEAD, and I looked at it and it's like, wow, that actually looks awesome. So why don't I spend some time in Asia as well? So I ended up moving to Singapore at some point and spending 4 years there. But then eventually my kids grew up, and we started thinking about college, and I wanted them to study in US, and they wanted to study in US. So at some point we said, you know what, it's probably time to go back, and to go back to our home country. So we were thinking about where to go back, and I talked to several schools, but ultimately I decided that Wharton is the best place for me. So I came back, and I've been here since 2017 now. So depending on how you count, I was at Wharton since 2001 with some short breaks in between. But even when I was at INSEAD, I was running Wharton INSEAD Alliance, so that kind of was kept me very, very close with the school.
Congratulations on that. It looks like you've had a fantastic run at both these institutions. So now that you have almost 2 years, 2 decades of immersion into the world of business and with your extensive background, how does the Innovation and Global Initiatives division at Wharton fit with what you were looking to do?
So when I came back to Wharton, I had discussions with then Dean Jeff Garrett. He asked me to run global initiatives first at Wharton, and my profile is kind of obviously fits. I was born in Russia. I lived in U.S., France, and Singapore. I traveled extensively. I've been to many, many, many countries in the world. On teaching assignments, on variety of research trips, and my kind of research agenda is very global. So that was a no-brainer. That was something that I wanted to do. And then over time, I added another kind of a title of innovation. And innovation at Wharton is basically anything that does not fit into a standard degree programs or kind of executive education, which is always existed. Degree, MBA degree, undergraduate degree, executive MBA, PhDs. These are stable divisions. They've been running for decades, and some for 100 years and more. From time to time, we try to come up with something which is innovative, which is disruptive, which we believe will change the future of the school. So my job is to kind of grow and incubate, start and incubate this kind of initiatives and see them grow until they become divisions on their own. So since I teach innovation and I wrote a book about business model innovation, that's what I do. I invest a lot in startups. I teach venture capital. I'm an investor in venture capital firms. So innovation is my life. Uh-huh. I spend about 50% of my life talking to startups and venture capitalists. And then the other half is talking to large corporations and trying to help them innovate. So that kind of fits squarely into what I do and my expertise. So I was very excited to add this to my portfolio.
So I was referring to your book, you know, the risk-driven business model, where there were these frameworks that you discuss. So I'm very curious about how do these frameworks enable the analysis and anticipation of, you know, changes in the landscape of business education?
I would say they fit very, very well. Business model innovation is a type of innovation that does not involve like inventing new technology or kind of creating new products or new services. It's basically you go to the same customers that you always serve, for example, and you build a different business model, usually using some off-the-shelf technologies. You don't invent any of that yourself. So, and that's a lot of what we do at Wharton, is trying to change the business model of a contemporary business school. You know, the business model of a business school is very straightforward. You know, you charge tuition, which typically is for degree programs, and that represents usually biggest part of your budget. Then you have endowment, it gives you some yield. If you're a state school, then government maybe gives you some money. Then you do a little bit of fundraising, and then, you know, depends on the school. Harvard might have much more from endowment, and Wharton might take more money from donations and degree programs, and then state schools will take more money from state schools. But, you know, by and large, you know, most top business schools operate according to this business model. And of course, if you ask a question like, where did this business model come from? When was it invented? Nobody remembers anymore. This was hundreds of years ago. And that's a bad sign. That usually means that disruption is coming. There's going to be a massive change, and the business model will have to be reinvented, you know. Mm-hmm. And technologies will roll to play in it, but what I say in the book is that technologies usually don't change the world. Mm-hmm. Technologies come and go. It's only when a technology finds a proper business model that's when it can disrupt entire industries, right? So, you know, from my book, if you take an example, I don't know, Uber, right? So did Uber invent any technology, any product? No, they used off-the-shelf internet, mobile, telephony, you know, GPS. Right. All of that was invented long time ago. Uber had no participation in those innovations, but they disrupted a big industry that was around for thousands of years, you know? So that's what's going to be happening in education industry, and we see some early signs of that.
So when you're seeing some of these disruptions happening, how do you? What are the top two or three disruptions that currently are on the top of your radar?
I'll name two. So one is a shift away from degree education. So increasingly, young people do not want degrees anymore, and they realize that degrees are extremely expensive, and value of degrees is more and more questionable. And so the shift is going towards non-degree, non-credit, short courses, maybe boot camps of sorts that give you specific skills that are relevant right now. Right. So do you want a degree in large language models and generative AI? Probably no. But lots and lots of people want a little upgrade, little update, bootcamp on what those technologies are bringing to a workplace. So that's a one massive shift that we are seeing. So there are fewer and fewer applicants to degree programs, to MBA, undergrad, and that's kind of happening across the world, across all institutions. The second massive shift is, of course, driven by technologies. And COVID had a huge role to play there. There were some attempts to digitize learning. There was, you know, some successes in asynchronous space like Coursera and so on. But then in COVID, we really poured a lot of money, a lot of expertise into redesigning our courses for digital delivery. And you can now see lots of innovative methods to deliver education without leaving your home. This became very attractive. A lot of people are now looking for this kind of a digital degrees, remote modes of education, and some more innovative ways to deliver personalized learning. You know, learning which is just targeting you, where you can go at your pace, not with the entire class of 100 people. So I think these are kind of two things that we are struggling with a little bit.
So I remember immediately post COVID, everybody went online, and right after COVID ended, I think there was a rush to go offline back again. And a lot of the online steam, if you will, it sort of subsided, right? And so while I think during COVID, there was this feeling that technology, everything would be always delivered online. And now, you know, I think business schools are back in their safe space. You know, they're like, here are my 800 students. You guys can't run away. You guys are going to pay me the fees. And so is there a continuous drive from institutions, including Wharton, to actually go ahead, lead and evolve and maybe even innovate in that space?
So definitely, I would say in some of our educational programs, digital is not going away. For example, executive education, which is, you know, for senior managers and so on. What we found is there is a big bipartite separation. There are people who say, I will never pay executive education fees if I am not in person, if I cannot shake hands, exchange cards and so on. That's, you know, networking is a big part of it. But then there is the other side, which says, I am so glad there are online courses now, because I could never come on campus. I have no time. I live far away. I have little children and so on, right? So we offer a lot of classes in two modalities. You know, you can come in person or you can come online. We don't offer, at least executive education classes, we don't do hybrid where, you know, you combine the two. So I would say in executive education is still very big. I teach programs in both modalities, pretty much the same content, except you cannot be on Zoom for like 10 hours a day, right? So we usually, a week-long program becomes a two-week-long program, 4 hours every day, right? So that is not going away. We did introduce a new executive MBA program, which is a global VEMBA program, which big part of it happens online. It's all synchronous. So, you know, you it's not a pre-recorded video or anything like that. You talk with a professor and so on, with your classmates. And we have awesome classrooms with, you know, 100 TVs where you can see everyone. And, you know, we adapted technology for that. But this program is targeting Asia, for example, and we find that executives in India, China, they don't want to travel to the United States every couple of weeks or every month. It's hard, time zones and so on. It's so much more efficient to have several face-to-face modules in Asia, probably, and, you know, some in the United States, but not too many, so that there is this connection, handshakes and networking. But then most classes happen online. So we have a separate cohort for that. We launched it this year. So this is an absolutely a modality that is there to stay. We also continue to use online for all kinds of exceptions, you know, faculty fall sick, or, you know, there is some other disruption, you know, and previously you would just cancel classes, right? But now we can just hold those classes online, right? So I think you are right. There is a kind of this hype with online subsided a little bit. I think a big reason is that if you want to run classes synchronously and you want a professor to speak with you in real time, what you find out is that the cost of delivering this kind of education is basically the same as in a classroom. You know, mm-hmm. professor's time is the same. You need TAs. You need, you know, you're not going to abandon your facilities. You already have them. That's a fixed cost, you know. Mm-hmm. And so the question is, if for the same price, I'm going to give you in person versus online, mm-hmm. most people are going to prefer in person, right? So they right. kind of somehow see a bigger value out of it. Mm-hmm. And for most people, it's easier to focus. You know, there is this social element, right? It's easier to network and so on. So I think there was a little bit of this pullback, but I think digital is there to stay with us for a long time.
So education and disruption. I mean, I think while for decades people have been speaking about it, but disruption, I think, you know, comes to education the last, right? I mean, mm-hmm. for multiple reasons, the way the industry is set up, the way professors are, the way, you know, campuses have been operating for hundreds of years. So when you are sort of leading the innovation lab, I'm wondering what kind of truly disruptive forces do you sort of see on the radar where you think that, you know what, these are possibly going to be truly disruptive in the areas of education?
I think as you pointed out, it's hard to disrupt education, and big reason is that education is very much a brand business, right? So Wharton has been, University of Pennsylvania exists since 1740. You know, we've been building our brand. We have an massive alumni network. Something like 500,000 people for the University of Pennsylvania, 100,000 people for Wharton. Any newcomer just cannot replicate something like this, right? And so as a result, I think top schools like Wharton, like University of Pennsylvania, we are not as much of a subject of those disruptive forces. Like, sure, demand for degrees is going down, but we are admitting one student out of 10. So we're going to admit one student out of 9 or 1 out of 8. That's not going to do much, right? I think where it really, really starts to kind of a bite is kind of at the middle tier schools, mm-hmm. which are struggling to justify high tuitions, where, you know, a person can say, hey, I can go and get online free courses at MIT, or, you know, Coursera courses from Wharton, you know. So I think this is where disruption is biting. And when people look at, like, okay, hey, I'm going, what is the difference between me paying this face-to-face tuition at a middle level university versus going completely online and taking degree from whatever University of Phoenix or one of the private schools, for example. So I think they see they're struggling. There are multiple universities that are closing, and, you know, business schools that are suffering financially, and they're increasingly trying to find other sources of revenues. Most of the time, what I see is happening is schools all over the place are launching online programs, mm-hmm. and they try to use a significant part of the content from asynchronous learning, pre-recorded lectures, right? That's much, much cheaper, and you can have many, many students in class, and some schools are quite successful in that. So mm-hmm. I see also schools are increasingly launching all kinds of master's programs. So that has been another kind of a popular way: master in management, master in finance. They're trying to tap into a different audience, which is a pre-experience, right? So you just graduate from undergrad, you can go and get a master's degree. MBA programs are not going to accept you, but you can get a master's degree, right? So that has been going on, I think, for the last, you know, 20 years or so. What we are doing, and I think this is trying to respond to this wave of what everyone is talking about, and it's called lifelong learning, right? And mm-hmm. and lifelong learning is tied to this diminishing demand for degrees, because people realize, like, look, you have to learn throughout your entire life. Innovations are coming, technologies are coming, you have to constantly update your knowledge. But you cannot keep getting degrees, right? So instead, what you are thinking about is this kind of a boot camps or some kind of executive programs at some point. So that's a kind of a big disruption. And a lot of schools, in response, they started launching these lifelong learning initiatives. And most of them think about it as educating older people, right? So continuing your education after MBA, after you got a degree, you still come back and we update you on whatever was, you know, kind of a current knowledge. We went beyond that and we are doing what I believe nobody is doing in the world. We said, you can also start earlier. You can start in high school. You can start in middle school. And there, no other business school is in this space. Some universities have like summer high school programs, right? Mm-hmm. As far as business schools go, we are the only ones who have a massive, we call it Wharton Global Youth Program. And that's mm-hmm. a program that I started at Wharton. We start students in high school, so 15 to 19 years old. We have a variety of programs. We run programs in summer, which are like 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks long. We run leadership and finance and entrepreneurship. And we run programs now in San Francisco as well. This year, we launched programs in Cambridge, UK. Next year, we're going to go to a couple of more countries. And also, we run mid-year programs where you can actually get credit. You pen credit, we run them online, we run them in person. We also run competitions, like today is a deadline for Wharton High School Investment Competition. We have hundreds of thousands of people participating from all over the world. So to us, this is a hugely overlooked space because business major is still number one major in the world. And so every year, something like 30, 40 million kids all around the world mm-hmm. apply for undergraduate degree in business. Typically, business is not taught in any high schools. Like you look around the world, it's right. no different. In US, some states started requiring you to learn basics of like money management, personal finance. That's it, right? But there are millions of kids out there who would like to learn about careers in business, you know, but there is no way to do it. It's just, it's not a part of high school curriculum. So we offer this opportunity. We also offer an opportunity to signal to undergraduate institutions when you apply to say, hey, I don't just want to study business. I actually already learned something. I went to the best mm-hmm. business school out there. I went to a summer high school program. So that's something we are betting on very, very big. And this market is huge. There are so many kids from, you know, China, India, Brazil, you know, UAE, who would like to go and study in the United States, for example. And what better way to prepare for it if you spend a couple of weeks, a summer before, living in a dormitory, you know, being taught by Wharton faculty, and learning kind of basics and thinking about, hey, you know, business is not just business. There is marketing, there is finance, there is entrepreneurship. Can be more quantitative, less quantitative. So that's a major, major innovation that that we are launching, that we launched a few years back.
So that sounds like a very fabulous program because it's very rare that business schools look towards helping kids. You know, at the end of the day, they want to really spend most of their time with graduates and executives. And you're sort of, you swung the pendulum to the other side. How did you make this change happen? I'm assuming this was not something that a business school would easily look into.
Well, we did have one advantage, which is we have by far the best undergraduate program in business in the world, right? So we've been number one always and will always be. And so when kids think about education, an undergraduate business degree, they first think Wharton. So they come to our website. And so just organically, years ago, some of our faculty who were just, you know, interested in some kind of programs for kids, they launched some program here, program there. So there are like some small programs running. At some point, we realized that, you know, this could be a threat or an opportunity. It depends how you look at it. It's a threat because having kids on campus is not trivial. You need all kinds of certifications and, you know, FBI clearance checks. And and so on. You have to also be very careful about liability and where they go and who oversees them. And so our kind of a first reaction was maybe we need to prohibit it. Mm-hmm. But then I was asked to look at this market, and I looked at this market and I did a bit of an analysis, and I realized that this is actually gigantic market. If you think about executive education market is kind of like this, then executive MBA is bigger, MBA is bigger, undergraduate is bigger. High school market is just enormous. It's as I said, like 30, 40 million kids every year applying to undergraduate degrees. None of them get any business education in high schools. And so we said, like, look, we are the biggest brand they know already. How about we make it even stronger? Imagine if there would be thousands and thousands and hundreds of thousands of kids who already learned in high school about Wharton, and then they become candidates for undergraduate degree, MBA, executive MBA. This is a true lifelong learning. What we did not kind of realize at the time is that it creates an enormous bond with our alums, because many of our alums said, oh, I would love my kids to learn about business at Wharton. And, you know, of course, they all want to send kids to undergraduate at Wharton, but our acceptance rate is very low. You know, there are only so many kids we can admit, but high school programs, no problem. You know, we you know, they're much less kind of competitive. Many of them, some of them are extremely competitive, mm-hmm. but many of them are not. And so our alumni were extremely excited about this. They wanted their kids to come and sit with Ben Franklin on a bench and, you know, trade stories like, oh, who taught you? And did you see this professor, that professor? So that was pretty amazing. Lots of alumni actually wanted to sponsor some kids so that kids can come without paying tuition, you know, for free. So that was also kind of an unexpected benefit. And another thing we realized is that we can also help prepare some underprivileged minority children for business careers, because many of them don't even know that such careers exist. And so we created all kinds of programs targeting minority, underprivileged students. We run free programs for like Title I schools in Philadelphia, which are basically, you know, in lower income mm-hmm. areas. We have a huge programs for historically black colleges and universities. So this kind of allowed us to democratize education by giving thousands and thousands and thousands of children a taste of what a business education at a leading business school looks like.
That is fantastic. So yeah. I'm sure that you're looking at a lot of initiatives that are being driven by you to address specifically the future of education. What are some of your plans to bring them to the market or to fruition over the next 2 or 3 years?
So definitely we're going to grow high school programs, take them globally. We are looking into like commuter programs. Just before COVID, we had a program scheduled in Beijing, China, where kids from the area just would commute every day without, you know, staying in a dormitory or something. We had to shut it down because of COVID, but we're going to restart those programs. We are looking to expand into embedded programs. Like imagine you have a high school in India, already a very good high school. Imagine that we could teach a Wharton class in your high school. This would be part of your curriculum, and we would deliver it digitally, for example, synchronously on Zoom or something like that. So increasingly, we are growing that part. We are moving into middle school. Believe it or not, middle school, and you know, I don't know if you're going to move to elementary school. That would be interesting. But we have interesting partnerships at the middle school level, because there are some subjects you can start learning very early. You know, you don't need to be rocket scientist to learn about entrepreneurship and, you know, some basics of banking and such. We are increasingly looking at this trend of non-degree education, and we are launching this year non-degree, non-credit classes for undergraduate students. So moving from high school to undergraduate and MBA. So imagine like a visiting MBA program, say you know, Indian Institute of Management. There is a great MBA program, but I'm sure they would love to spend 1 week at Wharton and get a sense of like how do you get at Wharton, right? It's not that maybe they cannot come to Wharton full time or don't want to come to Wharton full time, but I'm sure many MBA students would love to get like a week or a couple of weeks of Wharton education. So we are launching this year. So undergraduate programs, MBA program, executive MBA programs will be able to come to Wharton in summer for like 1-2 weeks, maybe in winter as well. You know,
okay.
So that's kind of addressing this, you know, non-degree, increasing demand for non-degree education. On the technology side, I think a big bet we are making on simulations. And, you know, simulations existed in business education for a while. I'm sure you played some simulations when you were in the MBA program.
Right.
And usually these simulations are, you know, they're fun, but they're like you go in and there are some numbers to plug in and there are some formulas that spits out some, you know, number at you and says, hey, here's how much profit you made. So this is not exactly engaging, you know. It's still good, but what we want to create and what we created actually, I would compare it with Fortnite for business education. You know, you talk to real people, you get on a Zoom call, you receive a slide deck, you need to send your own slide deck, you write email, you receive emails, you know, so very interactive. And this is a unit that I have that is called Wharton Interactive. So you can look it up online. You can go. There are a couple of free simulations you can play, like a short 60-90 minute simulations where real actors are, you know, recorded, digitized. And the new simulation that is coming out, I believe this month, is going to be completely powered by ChatGPT-4. So, you know, you're going to negotiate with ChatGPT kind of in the background. And this is what we are betting on. We believe this is what's going to replace case teaching method, because case method, you have to read 30 page document. Nobody wants to do it. You cannot make students read even like a 5-page document now, right? At best, they'll feed it into ChatGPT and ask it like summarize it for me, right? Which is why we want to go into a different kind of a technology route and say, you know, instead of case study, let's play a game. It's engaging. We have amazing results. 98% of the people who start this Wharton Interactive courses, they finish. It's completely personalized. You know, your experience, no two games are alike. You go in different routes. You give different answers to the same questions and you're routed to kind of a different reality. So that, we believe, is the future of business education.
So it's very interesting because I know that you are very technology focused. And currently, I mean, AI seems to be playing some major role in business and its evolution. So I see that you're sort of finding how to use ChatGPT, you know, in education. So what, according to you, are, you know, some of the challenges and some of the benefits that you see that AI is going to be providing in the area of business education?
The challenges come if you try to fight ChatGPT and other kind of a large language models. And, you know, if your mode of education is that you ask students to write essays, well, that's dead, because technology is going to write essays for them. And it's kind of useless to grade them. It's not going to be students writing. And people try to fight this and say, hey, you know, we're going to use software which is going to identify if it was AI written. Absolutely useless. Lots of false positives, false negatives. Like, you know, you cannot detect it with a few prompts. You can always adjust. And so this becomes undetectable. So I think all challenges come from this fighting. In reality, what you need to do, you need to embrace large language models, which is what I'm doing in my class in innovation. So my students start companies, they come up with ideas and then build prototypes and so on. And I tell them, you must use ChatGPT. There are academic papers written by a couple of colleagues of mine at Wharton in my department. They show that students become much more creative when they come up with ideas for startup if they use ChatGPT to help. Students become much more creative with visuals for startup. They become better at narrative because ChatGPT is very good at writing narrative for a startup mm-hmm. for you. You can create mm-hmm. cool videos, cool, you know, cool digitized voices, and you know, lots and lots of things, which allows you to prototype a business model of a startup in very little time at a very little cost. So if you kind of embrace it and say, like, look, let's actually use it to help you, then I think there are big advantages. There are still caveats with, you know, things like hallucinations. You know, it can produce something that, you know, doesn't exist. So you still need a human to cross-reference and verify that everything that ChatGPT told you is a reality, right? For example, but, you know, there are other models out there. You can train them on just a fixed amount of material and tell it, like, don't hallucinate, don't really even use any other materials on the web. So I think there are big possibilities opening up. You just have to embrace large language models.
So, you know, I know you're a very active angel investor and you sort of advise a lot of startup companies. Tell me, have you ever advised startups in the education space?
Yes. Yeah, of course. Yeah. That's one of my favorite spaces. I probably invested in 3 or 4 startups in this space over the years. And they vary from just platforms to find like education sources for you. There are some cool companies I invested more recently, which use generative AI to educate you about anything. Like, imagine, you know, you're working in Slack and, you know, your boss tells you, here is a problem you need to solve. Can you analyze this data for me? You don't know how to do it. You immediately ask, like, okay, how do I do that? And mm-hmm. little chatbot pops up and says, okay, watch this video, you know, do this. Now take a look at this mm-hmm. article, you know, let's now take your data. Let's define what you want to do with it. And mm-hmm. it kind of teaches you in the workflow, you know, unlike many other educational methods, which take you out from workflow and say, okay, go and spend 2 years in a degree program. So yeah, so those, I definitely invest in a tech companies.
And when you're looking at these companies, what criteria do you typically use for evaluating these companies?
Well, yeah, it's a difficult question. These are very, I invest at a very, very early stage. So at that point of time, a lot what you look at is a team, mm-hmm. you know, like this company with chatbot based on large language models. It was started by our PhD student who graduated from our department, and he's a professor at a leading business school. So, you know, I knew the team was solid. You know, his knowledge was absolutely superb. Mm-hmm. He actually programmed these large language models himself. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, my bias is I like to look at the business models because that's kind of my expertise. So I look at how they think about monetization. Look at the total addressable market size. You think a little bit about unit economics. What is the cost versus kind of revenue? So, you know, kind of a standard thing that I teach in my class, essentially.
Okay, I got that. So, you know, and this is a, you know, I've seen a lot of entrepreneurs, even in India, you know, they're working very hard and they're able to innovate across the board. However, whenever it comes to them, innovating in the education space, you know, we've not seen any outstanding successes. You know, they sort of come in, and I think COVID gave them a nice headroom where a lot of companies in the prep space in India grew. And so what I do find very surprising is that, you know, most of the tech companies, the sharpest people in the world, are able to innovate in any industry, you know, take travel, take search, take social media. But in education, it's very interesting that the best people are not able to provide a breakthrough sort of a disruption. So there is an unformed question in that. And so that question is, what do you think is happening there? I mean, what's happening when the best people are looking at this problem, but, you know, the problem fights back?
Great question. I mean, I think India now is probably the place where most successful edtech startups are born. You know, Emeritus comes to mind, and you know, a few others. But it is an extremely difficult industry to crack, typically because there are so many players. So imagine you created some, you know, simulation, for example, that you want to sell. And I deal with this all the time because, you know, we sell simulations, Wharton Interactive simulations, right? So first, I need to convince faculty that faculty should adopt it. And faculty will have to see through, you know, a demo, understand how it works, and maybe faculty will say, okay, sure, that sounds reasonable, you know, let me try it. Typically, like I teach once a year in September, October, probably too late for this class. So let's talk 2024. So in September, October, 2024, I'm gonna try it. Let's say it's great. And I say, oh, great. Okay, so I'm gonna adopt it. So real adoption, probably you're gonna give it for free to me for the first time. Then real adoption happens 2 years from now, right? Mm-hmm. So long cycle. Now, then question comes, I'm not gonna pay for it myself. There has to be someone who is paying, either my department or degree program. And so now I have to go to them and argue that they need to pay for it. They will want to talk to a startup and ask for some kind of a sort of a discount. Then my CTO is going to come and say, hey, how are we going to integrate it? Is there going to be some information sharing where we might be, you know, subject to some risks, right? Then budgeting office is going to come and say, hey, do you really need this? Maybe you can just use a book or something, which is cheaper. And then there's going to be some negotiation about information sharing and billing, all of this with long cash cycles. So yeah, we are a very messed up industry with lots of entrenched players, right? So it's a tough nut to crack, and it's very hard to find a place where you can just go and sell it to a concentrated group of people, you know. Like Harvard Business Press is highly successful with selling cases and other things. Well, because they built an army of salesmen who knock on my door every day, you know, and say, hey, you know, we have these new cases and so on. So unless you have this army, it's extremely hard to get to customers, you know. And then, of course, there are students, which is, you know, another challenge. You sell it to faculties and students use it. Maybe faculty screwed up something. Maybe faculty didn't give the right instructions or whatever, and students hate it. And then you don't even talk to students necessarily, right? So you don't know what happened. Sure. So there are many layers that you need to penetrate, and you have to have a lot of patience, unfortunately.
So, you know, with the whole test prep startup industry in India, you know, there came a time where it started to look like they started going after scale by hiring famous teachers from YouTube. Right. I mean, because they said this guy can teach and, you know, he's got an audience, so we're going to hire him. And well, a couple of $1 billion company have been built out in this space. And as soon as the teachers became famous on the new platform, the teachers left because, you know, they were not being treated well. And I was having a conversation with one of those teachers, and he mentioned that, and I was talking to him about EdTech, and he said, All is fine. I don't think these companies understand that teaching is about the teachers. You know, if you can't take care of the teachers, you know, there's nobody to deliver education in a trustworthy manner to the students. And technology-based founders do not seem to see that. They seem to think that, you know, computers are going to deliver education, or, you know, ChatGPT and its next iteration is going to deliver education. And so what is your view on that? Is that a blind spot for some of these edtech entrepreneurs, if you will?
I think in some ways, because largely, like, we at Wharton, we understand that our unique competitive advantage is brand and faculty, and these are inseparable, you know. A lot of our alums perceive our brand as like, oh, I had this great faculty who delivered really unique knowledge. And faculty at a business school like Wharton, we teach relatively little. So our main job is not to teach, it's to produce new knowledge that other schools can also use to teach to their students and to develop kind of science of business. I teach 6 weeks a year That's it. That's my entire teaching load. Actually, it's more than I need to, but you know. And so so that's kind of a not the biggest part of my job. For me in particular, it's mostly administration and research. And we know very well that you need to treat faculty well, which is why we get these sabbaticals, which allow us to go kind of all around the world, which nobody else has, basically. No other industry has a year-long sabbatical, and we have all kinds of great benefits in our work, because universities know that we are kind of the precious resource. Technical kind of founders, it's very hard to understand this. They want to scale, right? And how do you scale me, right? So I have kind of a limited time. It takes a lot of time. A lot of time to prepare a new class or something of that sort. So for every hour that I teach, I have to probably spend 3-4 hours preparing. This is going to be a precious resource. And to me, what I saw in a tech industry, where I think the first kind of a big newcomer was Coursera at some point. And Coursera established this, it was the first one. No one has seen anything like that before. It was very successful by drawing millions and millions of people to the platform. And Coursera from the beginning established this notion of revenue sharing between content providers and Coursera, which was 50-50 or something like that, right? And all the companies coming after Coursera, they use that as a kind of a benchmark, which I think is a very, very wrong benchmark. The content is so much more important than the contribution of the platform, which is, you know, marketing and all kinds of other things. But I talk to a lot of those startups and I see their business models, and a lot of them say, well, Coursera just takes your class and puts it on a platform and gets 50% for that. I'm also going to do this and that, so I want 60-70, and that just leads to mistreatment of content suppliers, you know. So that's kind of my biased view on how we came to this.
Okay, got that. So I have a final question. And so, you know, if you had to reimagine the MBA program and you had a free hand at it, what would you change? How would you rebuild it? Assume you do not have any of the traditional constraints.
Yeah, that's a great question. I think I would personally rethink lengths of the program. So we tend to try to keep it within like 1 or 2 years. That's a kind of a dominating format that exists out there. I think if you wanted to build it from scratch, I would say this notion that the program has to be of certain lengths is just nonsense. You, for example, after first year, maybe I want to go start internship. I like this internship. I want to stay on for a year or two and take the rest of my classes online. That should be possible. You know, I already got a great job. I already got what I wanted out of the program. I want to finish my education, but who says it has to be in person? Who says it has to be like with some cohorts or something? So I think I would integrate more tightly, and this is something that we do through global courses. So something that I run is what's called global modular courses, and we go to like 20 different countries in the course of the year, and we are the only courses that unite undergraduate students with MBA with executive MBA. You know, typically these three populations are separated, and their classes are completely separate. It's not clear to me that it has to be this way. You know, you definitely can have lots of commonalities. You know, if an undergraduate student is very, very advanced and wants to take a more advanced course, like, why not? We all have different skills, different levels, different experiences, you know, it should be possible. So, but because we have very different schedules, you know, undergrad is on semester schedule and MBA is on quarter schedule and executive MBA is on some weekend schedule, nothing is aligned, because one program was started 300 years ago, another 100 and another 150. So this historical kind of rigidities don't really allow us to more tightly integrate them with each other. So to me, I think like offering more flexibility to MBA students, by partially moving them to online and allowing them to do program kind of more or less at their leisure. You know, maybe there is a course that I like, but it's not offered next year because faculty is on sabbatical. Well, okay, I'm going to come 2-3 years later and, you know, I still can take it. So to me, that's, I think, is a big opportunity, which is currently, you know, we are struggling to implement. It's very, very hard.
So I'm going to add on just a tiny bit to that last question. You know, you have kids who have come back to the US to study. And if you had to sell them a course that you're launching and say, you know what, I'm going to be launching this, it's got no constraints, what couple of more things would you add to that course so that they say, you know what, you've aced that? What would it be?
I think some kind of a combination of in-class instructions and visits to companies, to interesting companies, maybe virtual visits. So probably the most interesting course that I taught in my life was innovation in China, when we actually took 30 students from Wharton and 30 students from INSEAD to Beijing. And we visited Alibaba, Baidu, Xiaomi, Huawei, you know, all the kind of a top Chinese startups. And this was absolutely fascinating. And, you know, it was so much learning for me, for students. We spent very little time in class. It was mostly just going and like learning from companies, getting tours and so on. If you could combine this a little bit, right? Have this class in, you know, Palo Alto, maybe in San Francisco or New York or, you know, Beijing. And you don't have to travel everywhere. Maybe there is some combination of, you know, virtual drop-ins where you can kind of see certain things through video. That, I think, would make a lot of our classes much, much, much better.
Got that. And on that note, I would like to thank you so very much, Professor Sergey. I think I've really enjoyed having this opportunity to talk to you. And thank you for being so candid and forthcoming in your discussions. It was a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you, Alvin. Great to see another alum. And, you know, hope to catch up at some point in person. If you're ever on campus, let me know.
I will do that. Thank you so very much. Have a good day. See you.
Very good. Thank you. Bye. Have a good day. Bye-bye.